Are you listening? Damn.
Welcome to another amazing episode of Boss Talks, and I'm here with the amazing, unstoppable, fearless mum, Christine Drummond. And today we have been like, well, recently we've had in the world things are challenging, and we've had things that headwinds, just like everyone else. We've got the same headwinds, and then challenges in business, and all these crazy things. And we, Christine and I, both look to ways how we can take advantage of, you know, the situation. We look at things as if it's an opportunity to grow, and that's why one thing we always do is we like to come and share what we learn on our journey with you guys as soon as we possibly can. We love doing the podcast. And on the topic of sharing, guys, help us out. If you find this valuable, or you found anything we've done valuable or not, leave us a review. Tell us what you think. Tell us a topic that you might want us to cover, something that would be important to you. Give it a share. If someone needs to hear this, if someone's doing it particularly tough and they need to hear something, you know, guys, it's free. It's free to share. So share it. Share the love. Help us get our message out, because we are here to help you become the boss of your life and take the reins of, like, the steering wheel of the vehicle that you're in right now to get you to the goals of your masterpiece life. And even more so lately, I think the word fearless has come to the forefront. So fearless, one of the things I've been doing recently, and I was talking to Christine about, it's been important to me over many years, is something called the 75 hard. And whilst doing my third round of the 75 hard, I'm in about day 17 now. Basically, whilst looking at some of the stuff, because it's Andy Frasilla's program, and I follow the guy. He's awesome. And I'm so grateful that he's helped so many people, including myself, my family. Like, literally, we're up to hundreds of people have done it with us, Christine, just alone. Like, so I follow what he says, and I was watching his stories, and I came across a quote that he shared about David Goggins. And David Goggins is he's a bad mofo. He's like, an illegal sense. I mean, like, he is one of the toughest men on the planet. The things he's done, are crazy. Like, he's done the SEAL training 3 times. He's like, look, the list goes on. And he wasn't always that way. He was, you know, without ruining his story too much. I ended up finding David Goggins before, but then seeing Andy Priscilla mention him, I thought it's time to read the book. So I started to read the book, and wow, where he came from, which was a guy that had one of the worst imaginable upbringings that you could think of. He's overweight. He was like deemed to be stupid, dumb, like he has learning disabilities. He has all these things. And for what he's been able to achieve, for the most part, on his own, has been incredible. And what really happened for me is, like, I'm doing the 75 hard, I'm doing 2 45-minute workouts, and like, I'm thinking, how do I dial this up a bit? And I start listening to that book, and then you just got to run. I'm telling you, you just got to run. And the amount of times that I've like wanted to back off a little bit and like maybe take the easy way out on the 75 hard, as in like, hey, you can choose to go for a run or you can go for a walk. You know, it's open, it's up to you. And I tell you, since I've been listening to this book, it's been running no matter what, blistered feet, whatever. And I guess this wafflingly long intro, Christine, is just what we're going to speak about it today, because so many people now in this world have gone soft. They want to take the easy way out. We're all so busy multitasking on our phones and everything like that, and looking for the easy way, the magic pill that's going to make it all happen for us. And we've kind of forgotten where we came from, which is cavemen and women that did hard stuff. Like, it was hard to hunt the boar. It was hard to, you know, and like, wow, this is going to be so much fun. So, like, hey, Christine, jump in, save it.
Awesome. I love that intro, and I love the story of David Goggins as well. And, you know, there's no place for growth, guys, when you're playing small, when you are not stretching yourself. You know, you can't grow in that situation. And what I'm seeing, and Joel and I were talking about this before the podcast today, we're like, well, what's coming up with our clients? What's coming up with our team? What are some of the things out there that we're noticing? And what we're noticing is that a lot of people are settling. A lot of people just are not willing to stretch themselves, to challenge themselves, to see what this body, mind, and spirit can do. You know, we're buying into other people's perceptions of what we're capable of, rather than going, well, let me show everyone what I'm capable of. So the 75 hard, and I know we talk about it a lot, but it is life-changing for so many people. And you're right, Joel, like from us doing it, now we've had that ripple effect to other people doing it, and then they've had ripple effects in their own families and their friend circles, and now they've had people do it. And it's just been incredible to watch the growth and the impact that has had, and the realizations that people are having around themselves and how they have been playing small and, you know, just getting caught up, I guess, in the monotony of life. So what we want this podcast to really do is to help you guys start thinking a little bit differently. I know sometimes that we can get caught up into everything else that's happening externally to us, but a lot of it we can't control, guys. So why put any more focus and energy towards the things that we can't control? Why not direct your focus to things that are going to lead to personal growth, to personal success, to being more conscious and present with the people that you love, you know, rather than living in a state of fear and worry and, you know, just settling and being content? Why not go and challenge yourself and do things for you that are going to bring you more joy in life? So, you know, we're talking about the path of most resistance. And, you know, I see a lot of people out there taking the easy way out, you know, looking for the quick fix, choosing the path of least resistance. And it's not challenging them enough. It's not getting them to step up as a human. It's not getting them to set a higher standard for themselves. So we really want you guys to have a think about this and go, well, where in my life could I choose a path of most resistance, where I can grow my skills, where I can reinvent myself, where I can become a better version of myself, where I can find that balance in life where you feel more of the positive emotions and less of the negative. So, yeah, Joel, I love this topic, and I've got so many stories around me of where people are triumphing, you know, over their challenges every day, like focusing on the solution, like, you know, seeing the problem and going, you know what, yep, that's shit, but let's focus on the solution. What can I do to change this? What can I do within myself? And, you know, we talk a lot about self-development and growth within our teams, and it's beautiful to watch people that are prepared. They don't always want to do it, but they're prepared to step outside that comfort zone because they know it's essential to their growth. They know it's essential to their success and to their happiness. And we get to see that on a daily basis. But on the flip side of that, we also get to see what happens when people are comfortable and they don't, they're too fearful to take that step across that line. So, Joel, what I'd love you to share with the listeners is, how do you get people to, I suppose, overcome the challenges, the limiting beliefs, the negative self-talk, and then also thrown in there is the external influences, the voices and opinions of others, you know? And sometimes that's loud, but people aren't actually even saying anything. You know what I mean? Like, it's all in our head. We're running these stories thinking what we think other people are thinking of us, and it's not true anyway. So what's your advice around that?
Yeah, well, like the first thing is, like, you're going to be often, like, you got to learn to understand that challenges are put there for you to have an opportunity to grow. Like, They're not there to, like, the universe isn't going to put anything in front of you that you can't handle. It's actually there as an opportunity. So instead of like looking at thing like challenges as a negative, like put them there and realize that it's been put in front of you. And you just think, how amazing am I going to be once I overcome this? Because realistically, we're a lot stronger than we even give ourselves credit for, you know? So like you don't grow without failure. So like failure, what if failure was your goal? What if you actually went out and went, today I'm going to run until I can't run anymore. Or I'm going to speak to so many people and make so many sales calls that until I literally fall asleep on the keyboard. Like, now this is going to fly in the face of so many self-love gurus that tell you that that's, you know, you'll burn out and everything like that. But, you know, like failure could be the goal. Like you go to the gym and instead of saying, I'm going to do 3 sets of 10 at this weight, you go, I'm going to do 3 sets until I literally can't lift the bar off myself, you know? And then you like, cause how else are you going to know how good you are? Like how far you can go? Like how else are you going to know if you're always keeping something in reserve because you're so frightened of failing? Like that's, you know, like think about it. Like the people that fail, that can actually come back, face their failure, dissect it and realize what they could do differently next time and then just get back on the bike and go back out and get in the field again and just have another go. Like that's how the sports team do it, right? Like they look at their wins just as much as their failures. They look at every little bit that they've done and realize how they could do it better. And that really comes back to something that I learned from Curry Cashley is like, you know, what did I do great? How can I make it better? And by what percentage did I improve by? Like, you're not always going to win just because we've got like, and this brings me onto a bit of another rant. The world has, and the marketplace and the way the media is and the way things are, and even in the self-development area, like industry, we're taught to think that we're entitled to whatever dream we put in our mind. We think, just because we go out and think that I'm, like I could think that I deserve to run a 100-mile ultra marathon and I could go out and train for the next year and get really fit and do it and everything like that. And I could go out and I could be as prepared as I want to be or as I could be and go out and still fail at it. You know what I mean? I could make 80 miles instead of 100, I could make 99. You never know. You never know when your body's going to give out, but at least I'd know. And the people that are going to sit back and criticize you, those voices, they're not even on the field. They're criticize. Most people that criticize you haven't even tried what you failed at. They're sitting in their armchairs, giving you well-meaning advice in a lot of respects. You know, they're doing it from a place of love. That's what it's guised in. It's actually from a place of fear because they're frightened that you might actually do it. And then what will that mean about them? So don't worry about it because I can guarantee you, and this is hard to swallow, we're not that important. People aren't thinking about us. Like I'm really close friends with Christine and she's really close friends with me. We'll finish this podcast and she's going to be thinking about her kids and I'm going to be thinking about what I'm doing. Like we're not thinking anything about how we performed on the podcast other than like or what we've done at all. And no, I don't think, Christine, have you ever had anyone ring you up like a year later and go, you know, that Facebook Live you did a year or 2 years ago, that really was terrible. Like just
never.
You just go do it, hey. So like, yeah, like I think that something that I'm investigating in my own head is like, what if failure was my goal? What if I went out and I just went as hard as I could and just found out where my failure point is? Because until you go for it, I don't know what it is. Like, I don't know. Like I ironically, when we did stairs in Melbourne, I found it. Like that was me giving my best. Like I just had nothing in the tank and I analyzed that and I was like, fuck that. I don't want that to happen again. So like in one day I'll hit the stairs again. I don't want to be bottlenecked like I was that day. Like that was, it was different terrain, like blah, 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 heaps of excuses, but I just didn't have the leg strength to do it. So I want to, yeah, And that could work for money. That could work for anything in your life. Like, you just, I didn't fail. I finished it. But for me, I was like, how can I do this better? Like, I didn't live up to my own standards. So yeah, that's what I reckon. Just go for failure.
I love that. And you didn't fail that day. We got it done.
So. I got it done. Oh, I was done though.
That was definitely the toughest stair session I've ever done. Oh my gosh, that was grueling. I think a lot of it too, Joel, comes back to, you know, what habits are we implementing on a daily basis? Are we implementing habits like growth habits, you know, empowering habits, or are we implementing habits that are, you know, keeping us comfortable and keeping us at a level where, you know, we're content? So for me, like, I love the thrill of the chase. I love the challenge. I love, you know, being able to see what, you know, what my body can do, what my mind can do, you know. Like, I'm learning the saxophone at the moment, and it's been one of the most frustrating things I've ever done, because one, I can't read music, so I've had to go right back and learn how to read music. I'm having to learn quavers and quivers, and I don't even know what they are, you know. And even some of our sessions, we sit there for 30 minutes and I have to clap for 30 minutes, like learning the beats and, you know, using, you know, different parts of my brain so that I can recognize different notes and everything like that. And it's so challenging. And there's been many times where I'm just like, you don't need to play sax. Like, why don't you just throw it all in? Why don't you just give it up? That would be me choosing the path of least resistance, you know, and I'm not going to achieve anything apart from regret if I give up, you know. So that's just one small example, but where else is that showing up in life, you know? And I remember my personal trainer a few years ago teaching me to fail in the gym, because failure was a word that I just never used. I always just kept going to my limit, never beyond, just kept doing what I knew I was capable of doing. And of course, I wasn't getting the results that I wanted because I wasn't prepared to go past that line. And for anyone that wants results in regards to their physicality, I see so many women, like I'm a member of a gym here, and I see so many women that go to the gym that do the same exercises over and over again every day, sometimes twice a day, and they're wondering why they're not getting the shifts in body shape or they're not developing their strength. And it's because they're not prepared to go to failure. They're not prepared to see what their failure limit is. And, you know, if that's you, because that used to be me, so I can totally relate to this, but if that's you, then why not do what Joel said and maybe change your mindset around and go, you know what? I wonder what would happen if I just went to failure. And today my trainer kicked my butt and we went to failure. I literally should have probably worn a mouth guard to the gym today because I fell on my face, you know? But that's what it's about. It's about pushing yourself, and then you've got that sense of accomplishment. You know that you can put your head on that pillow at the end of the day, knowing that you gave it your all. You gave it your best. And, you know, that's what we teach our kids as well. As long as you're trying your best, you can't beat your best, you know, but you have to see what you're actually capable of and where those limitations are. So I think you've got a really cool story around this actually, Joel, that we were sharing. You know, I think it was it David that was out there when he was running that ultra marathon? And I'm not going to give the story justice, so I'd love you to share it, but it's all about, you're not competing against anyone, guys. You're competing against yourself. And as long as you don't give up, you're going to finish. You're going to make it to that line. But I want Joel to share this story because I think it's really relevant in here while we're talking about, you know, sort of the fitness side of things.
Yeah, it's amazing. Like, and like what I like loved about your saxophone, where that your brain gets to your head and tells you like why you need to be doing this. You got all these things like, and that that's a common theme all through David Goggins' book, because he didn't have to prove anything anymore. He'd well and truly proven himself to be one of the toughest people on the planet multiple times. He's made a living off doing what is impossible or deemed to be impossible. So like, so he was a SEAL. He didn't need to do any more, but he was always looking how to get into another branch of the defense forces to find where the uncommon people were, because he wanted to be uncommon around uncommon people. So when the rest were like, they're doused in freezing cold water for days on end, no sleep, and everyone's like, he calls it jackhammering, they're shivering, he refused to shiver. So he held his mindset so strong that he would not give the people that were training him the credit that they've gotten to him, you know. And it's a really alpha book, and the good thing is I think the world could do with a bit more alpha in their life. And it doesn't mean that it's like masculine, although he's a dude talking about kicking goals. So like, speaking about the run, like one of the things he does is ultra marathons, and he's doing this 100-mile race just so he had the privilege of being able to apply for another ultra race. So there's one that gets done in Death Valley, which is the most grueling one on the planet. And he wasn't allowed to get into it, so he had to do this other one. And he had to do it in under 36 hours. And it was like horrible terrain. And basically, of the 200 people that start, usually only about 40 finish. It's that bad. And it's just like, it's five laps. And there was a guy that was going, that was also in the race, and he was going for the race record. And it was, he was going for 22 hours or something crazy like that, race record. Like And basically this guy was like a gazelle. He's like floating across the, you know, had his technique. He was a master of his craft in that. And David Goggins is this huge, you know, African American, muscly bound, like as big as they can be. Only black guy in the race, like he makes mention of that, like, and just really big. And he's out there running, and he's in super pain, and he's not even with. So when you go on these races, in this particular one, David Goggins wasn't within, 10 miles of anyone either side. There was no one even remotely close to him, because the everyone goes at different paces, and you just, over those 100 miles, it really spreads out. And basically he was such a competitive guy, and he realized when he was about to give up that he's not in a race with that guy that's going for the, that for first. Even though he was in the same race, he wasn't in the same race. He was only racing against himself. And it's so ironic that, and then he realized that he's only ever racing against himself. You're only ever going against yourself. So how can you actually fail if you're not really, can't lose when you do that? You're only just going against yourself to see how far you can take it. And ironically, when I heard that part of the story, I had my headphones on. I was in the middle of a bloody run, right? So any thoughts of me taking it a bit easier, or not that I do when I'm on a run, I'm about the business then. But I did extra laps, because what it got me to do is question, like, hey, could I keep going? Could I actually, if I wanted to, keep going? And the answer was yes, so I did. And that has actually translated into my kids. That's translated into some other people that I've been speaking to, that attitude where I just have the discussion and just, I don't tell the full story, but like, I'm just like, hey, if a velociraptor or a tiger was chasing you, could you keep running now? And they're like, absolutely. I'm like, well, then you're not done then, are you? You know what I mean? And we're not even going on the other side of the equation, are we, Christine, where, you go into overtraining. Like, he does speak about this. So it's not all just, hey, he doesn't say go and turn up to a race with no training like he does. He goes, that's me. As I'm, but he does say, well, you might, like, at the moment I'm running at least seven times a week for 45 minutes. And, I get to a certain distance. Well, then every week or fortnight, I need to measure that and up it by 5%. And if I did, so just imagine I'm running, let's say 8Ks, and I can up it by 5% every fortnight. In 12 months, I'm going to be running significantly better, and I'm going to be a lot better than I am now, and a lot closer to my best self and what I want to be. So, that's it. You're only going against yourself, Christine. And once you're in your own head, and everything else gets shut out. And you're like, well, how good can I get? Because now I'm not, I don't even care whether my, maybe my best today I thought was 5 minute Ks, but maybe it's really 4 minute Ks. What if I ran for 4 minute Ks for running? It starts to get fun. I don't know. Maybe we're just different. That's what he says, actually, Christine. He goes, I'm not like you. We're not the same. That's what he says.
Yeah, I like that he seeked out those uncommon people, you know, which a lot of us are not doing. We're participating with the sheeple, you know, and a lot of our peer group often holds us back as well because they're living comfortably, you know, and I see this a lot. Like alcohol is a big issue, you know, in our society, and I see it holding a lot of people back out there, but they do it because it's socially acceptable, you know, and, you know, I've got a few friends that are doing the 75 hard that used to be really big drinkers, and the mental clarity that they're getting now, you know, and all the other amazing health benefits from, you know, from cutting the alcohol out, they're now seeing that, you know, they don't have to be that person. They don't have to go back to the disempowering habits that they used to have. Now, that's not to say, like, people go, you know, I still have a drink every now and then, but it's definitely not to the extreme that I used to, you know. And I think, you know, it's about, you know, implementing those habits that are going to lead you to the person that you would love to be. You know, so many people say, I'd love to be like that, or I'd love to do that, or I, you know, I wish I could do that. Well, go and do it. Like, who do you need to become to go and do that? Like, my sax playing is I'm only doing it because I got sick of my own voice saying, I wish I could play the sax. Oh, I wish I could. I've been saying it since I was like a teenager. And then finally this year, I was like, stuff it, go and get a tutor and start learning it then, you know? So where can you show up like that? Where are you getting sick of hearing that same story, that same record that you've been playing over and over again? Where are you sick of hearing that and seeing that show up? Where you're just like, you know what? These people are right. Like, I've got something here has to change. Because if it doesn't change, you're going to have regret, guys. You're going to have regret. You're going to have guilt. And you're going to live a life of worry and fear. And no one wants to live there. Well, maybe some of you do. I don't know. But I'm assuming that not a lot of you want to live there, right? You listen to this podcast. Hopefully you're listening to other things that are empowering you and lifting you up and helping you raise your standards. And if that's you, like, hopefully that's the kind of listeners that we're attracting, is the people that they do want to be better. They do want to do better, you know, in all areas of their life. And, you know, money's another one, Joel. Like, we talk to a lot of people. We actually run workshops around money, and people wish they had more money. They're the wishes in our society. I wish I had more money. I wish I could do this. I wish I could say yes. And then they do nothing to develop their skills in the area that they want to see improvement. Like, if you want more money and you wish you had more money, then what habits or systems are you implementing, or what skills are you developing in order to get more money? And sometimes it's not even about getting more money, it's about being smart with what you've got coming in and organizing it in a way that is growing your wealth over here. So we're not saying go out there and, you know, get another 5 jobs and do all that. Sometimes it's just making small changes to your weekly habits that is going to be able to, you know, I don't know if you guys know this, but over the course of 10 years, just $250 a week put away in an account compounding is going to lead to around $150,000 in 10 years. Now, if I could guarantee that in 10 years' time, you're going to have $150,000, would you be prepared to put away $250 a week? Of course you would. And if you are thinking, Christine, I don't have that in my income right now, well, get resourceful. How could you create an extra $250 a week that you didn't need to touch, that you could still live on what you're earning, and then have this $250 building up, building up, building up, to a point where you don't touch it? And these are the kind of skills that we teach people. And it's not difficult. It's just about having systems and habits in place that are going to lead to a desired outcome. But so many people just sit there, they wish, They get distracted by Netflix and all sorts of stuff. For me, if I watch Netflix, it's kind of like a little bit of a reward. You know, you've got all your income producing activities done. You've done all your work for the day. Yeah, now tonight you can have some switch off time. And sometimes that's exactly what I use it for, is to, so I can switch my brain off being in the job, you know, and, you know, chasing that next goal, that next dream. Sometimes I need to just switch totally off and just watch something where I can just, you know, be a bit of a vegetable basically. So, but some people are the opposite. You know, they go to work and then it's the first chance they get, they'll sit there for hours and just feed their mind and get distracted and not, you know, have these growth practices in place. So have a think about, you know, what's your number one priority in life right now? Like if you were to really ask yourself that, what's important to you right now? What's most important to you right now? And a lot of you are going to say family, but how often are we taking our family for granted and we're not spending that present conscious time with them in a way where we're feeling calm and blissful? You know, most of the time, and this was me, I started to become that yelling mum. You know, I was spending time with my kids, but it was detrimental because I was getting frustrated and I was blaming them for things or for taking my time when I should have been doing other things. You know what I mean? So imagine if you could put more empowering habits in place that allowed you to switch from job life or career or your business to now being, you know, that loving, caring parent that I know a lot of you want to be, to being that loving, present partner for your other half. Like, imagine having a life like that, that was less stress, less reactive, less overwhelm, and more feelings of bliss and happiness and ecstasy and elation and all those kind of things. I don't know about you, but that's definitely what I'm striving to feel more of. So I don't know, Joel, if I've gone on a massive big tangent, but I just really want people to get that sometimes it's as simple as just switching habits.
Absolutely. Look, like the problem with people is that they're accepting to be normal. They want to be normal. They want to fit in. They don't want to stand out because, look, we get hate like for who we're becoming, Christine. I know you get hate. I get hate. Like, and probably not as much as we probably don't even notice the people that might be talking about us. I know that's like not that contradicts what we said at the start, and that it's when you're out there doing something, it's the people that you're on the field, you're on the battlefield having a go, that people can throw the rocks from the sideline because they're not actually on the battlefield. So I actually don't care what those people say anymore. And hey, that takes work. I don't actually give a shit. Like if they don't like, I'm part of an amazing health company. And if people don't like that, then that's okay. I'm not expecting everyone to like it. You know, people think that, you know, me as a coach and the coaching industry is a certain thing they have opinions about. I don't actually care. It's, you know, like who wants to be normal? What if you just got up every morning and you just said, I refuse to be normal. And you just did that. That's what you went out the door and you start thinking, what would someone who's abnormally successful do today? What would they do right now? How would they act? What decisions would they make? You start asking those really great questions in your head and your reticular activating system is going to go start searching them out for you. And then they're going to start coming in front of you. And here's this kicker, guys. It wasn't the decision that made those opportunities come in front of you. They've always been there. You just haven't been looking for them. So start looking for them. So like, guys, easy isn't better. Like not watching Netflix is hard. Not eating cake is hard. Not like working on your business is hard. Working out is hard. You know, having some discipline is hard. You know, not being the yelling mum is hard. Not making excuses is hard. It's like, that's all the easy stuff. Like holding back spending your money on shit that doesn't matter is hard because society is programming us to do exactly the opposite, to be dependent on the government, be dependent on, you know, all these major corporations, everything like that. It's designed to make us feel like we can't do anything. Like, an amazing thing that a mentor of mine said to me was, Joel, like, stop doing everything for everyone in your team. And I was like, okay, well, I kind of already done that, but for a different reason. And she says, I used to do that as well. She goes, but what you're doing is you're actually disempowering them. You're actually not helping them. And I was like, oh, okay. She said, every time you go and do something for them, you're actually telling them that they can't do it themselves. They're not good enough to do it themselves. And realistically, like, I was doing any of that stuff from a place of love. I wanted them to be successful, but what I was doing was I was disempowering them because I was making them dependent on me. So it's a big change, right? So, like, realistically, we are chemicals and electrical impulses wrapped up in a meat suit. And it's, you know, we have external things happen that create a feeling, which creates an electrical impulse and chemicals in our body. And, you know, one of them is dopamine. And your body is just so simple. It's so, like, it's amazing, but it's also very simple. It's like you're either getting dopamine or you're feeling pain. That's it. That's all your brain recognizes, okay? So it's always designed to look for the easiest way, the path of least resistance, to get you that dopamine hit. Now, let me explain. Before there was cake, before there was Facebook, before there was a phone, before there was technology, back when we were like hunter-gatherers, the way a man would get dopamine would be to go out and go hunting and hunt and bring back a big boar to feed the tribe. And the women would get dopamine from doing a really great job of doing what they were doing, you know, fulfilling their roles. And the way you got more dopamine, or, you know, would be to raise your standing in the community. Kind of like what happens now, right? But that's relatively hard, and dopamine hits were few and far between. But what's happened over time is we can now get dopamine hits all over the place. Like, every time you open your phone to check Facebook, you're getting a dopamine hit. That's why you're addicted to it. That's why if you actually put a counter, there's an app that counts how many times you open Facebook on your phone. If you put that on your phone, you will probably fall over. I'm like, and I know I'm speaking to a broad audience now, but you'll probably die. You'll go, oh my God, I've opened it 397 times today. Like, holy crap. So here's the thing. Before there was phones, because it's getting worse, before there was phones and Facebook and all that kind of stuff, and I'm just using that as to illustrate an example. It's not the only thing. But before that, we had to raise our social standing and get our hit from dopamine from doing something like being really fit and healthy or building a business and becoming really successful. That's how we would get fulfillment and dopamine hits. And that's how we would be moving away from pain into joy, into pleasure. Well, now with all these other ways to get dopamine hits, like, work it out. Getting a six-pack set of abs takes time in the gym, watching your diet, all these things. And it could take 6 months, could take 12 months. You might never get one, you know, but it could take 12 months to get that dopamine hit from that activity. Or you can get that same dopamine hit from eating cake. That's why we're fat. That's why the planet's fat. You could work on your business for 7 years and still not make it, go broke, or you could, like, work really hard and you could be one of the ones that make it. It could take you 5, 6, 10 years to get to that goal of that successful business, or you can open Facebook. And the crazy thing is, your brain doesn't know the difference. It doesn't recognize that. It just knows, oh, great, I'm getting dopamine. Let's do that more. That was really quick. It looks for the path of least resistance. And I don't know, like, you could do a thing called, it's called a nightmare mode, something I found, where you just you starve your body of dopamine from any other source other than your goals. And they call it a nightmare mode because, like, it's no way to live. They even admit it themselves, but it's good for a reset. And actually, the amount of dopamine humans are getting right now in their body actually ages us. It's there's studies coming out now. Like, I don't have any clinical peer-reviewed stuff, but I'm actually seeing evidence where people that have like gone through and detoxed their dopamine hits that they get from today's society are actually de-aging. Because when the body, human body's not designed to produce dopamine hits at the level that humans do right now. So I guess, Christine, when Keurig Ashley told me that you lose yourself in the city, but you'll find yourself on the farm, away from all that, like, he wasn't kidding. So yeah, I'm up for some de-aging, and I think Vicky would be too.
I love that, mate. And it's so true. Like, you see the worry warts, you know, the people that are always worried, and, you know, they definitely look a lot older. So I guess that's it from us, guys. I mean, I hope you got a lot of value from this podcast today. If nothing else, you know, challenge yourself over the next 7 days. And, you know, if you've got an option to take the easy path or a harder path, take the harder path this week. You know, choose to go that extra mile. Choose to do what doesn't come naturally or easy to you and see what happens. I bet you that your life will be elevated because of it, you know, and you'll have new experiences. You'll be prouder of yourself as well. And, you know, and that's a really cool place to live. So, you know, don't work for other people's, you know, recognition and opinion. Work for your own, you know, be proud of yourself. And start being kinder to yourself as well. It's definitely one word that that I've implemented this year is kindness, but also forgiveness. You know, just forgiving yourself for not being where you are at in life or with fitness or money or whatever. But, you know, the best day to start working on it is today. Like, stop putting things off. Just take the action. You're like, you've got to do the work. There's no way around it. Now, if you want a better life, you have to do the work. It's not going to magically happen for you, okay? No one is coming to save you. So I don't know, Joel, have you got anything you want to close out with?
I was going to just let it go. And then it's funny you brought that up, which I had to realize that, you know, that I'm not against anyone else. It's just me. And that, fair enough, I'm in the position I'm in now. And it's not, it might not be ideal or where I want to be, but, you know, like, you're exactly right. It's all about, would have been great if I improved my health 10 years ago to the level that I wanted, but that time's gone. So getting upset about it's not going to do anything. But what can I do today? Well, today I can do the 75 hard. Today I can read more David Goggins and get more, even more impressed with it, but and follow his teachings. And I guess one of the teachings he does, which I loved, because I just see the industry once again, they do this, and I'm not knocking self-love. I think it's super important. I teach it. I think that there's one part that they miss though, which is telling the truth about where you really are. I'm not trying to get people to bash themselves, but like, at all. And you're not helping anyone if you're just telling a fib about yourself, you know? So what he does is he goes, you go and have an interview in the mirror. And, you know, you hear the self-love people saying, yeah, that's exactly, yeah, go self-love yourself. And he says, take, you know, strip down if you got to, whatever, and tell the truth about what you see back, what you see staring you back in the mirror. So if you're fat, get a post-it note out and write that you're fat and stick it on the mirror. And that's not to make yourself feel like a piece of crap. It's literally to say, look, this is where I'm at. I'm fat. So you put that on there and then you go, okay, so what do you need to do? Like, so where have you got to get to? So then you write where you got to get to and you stick it on a sticker note. And in between, you write, what's got to happen this week for me to get that goal of where I've got to go? And then another one, stick it up, saying, what are you going to do today? And your job is to rip all those post-it notes down because you've got the goal. Now, that is like very military, very hardcore, and probably a little bit tough for some people to hear, but it's like, I have to believe that that's what I needed to hear. And it's how I've always done. I've never got a goal that's worth having by pretending that I'm all good with where I'm at. You know, I'm blissfully dissatisfied, as Ed Milet says. And he says peacefully dissatisfied, actually. So he's at peace with the fact that he's not satisfied, you know, where he's at. And he says something like, you know, that he doesn't believe there's ever a finish line. He's always looking to the next challenge. So, guys, if that's you, if you want to know more, listen to the David Goggins book or go read it. It's called Can't Hurt Me. He's got steps. I really recommend the audiobook because it's got stuff in it, like interviews with him that he where he goes into so much more depth than what you get in the book. So it's really, really great to have both, but the audiobook's really great. So, yeah, it might be the kick up the pants you need. So I don't know, Christine. Now I'm done.
I love it. I love it. Awesome podcast, mate. We look forward to sharing some more with you on the next one, guys. Have a great day. Damn.